Hello, fishing friends. Welcome to another episode of The Fishing Podcast. I'm your host, Landon DeKaiser, and this is where I interview industry greats, average Joes and Janes, biologists, conservationists, and everything in between. My goal is simple. I want to inspire anglers to catch more fish, more places, more often. Okay, so I just got done recording a really cool podcast with a father and son duo, Tom and Max Werkman of Werkman Outfitters here in the state of Michigan. And these guys fish for everything. They do ice fishing, guided trips, salmon, steelhead, smallmouth, pike, largemouth, you name it. They are out there chasing whatever you want to catch. And with tons of experience on the water, these guys know what they're doing. And we cover a wide range of topics. But a couple of the key things that I wanted to ask them during this podcast is we're in the middle of February. Actually, we're in the end of February now. And if you're an ice fisherman or you're a steelhead fisherman, you know very well that the bite slows down this time of year. For whatever reason, I think it's just the brutal cold temperatures. But if you're out on the ice, it's tough to put a bunch of fish on the ice and bring them home for dinner. That's for damn sure. Steelhead, the same thing. It gets slower and slower. It's starting to pick up this time of year. But I picked their brain a little bit on what you can do while you're out on the ice to increase your chances on catching more fish. And I think they gave a really, really good answer on that, as well as Max gave a really good response to my question of, okay, how do you catch winter steelhead fishing when things slow down? And it's a two-part answer. And he answers to, well, are you talking about real fishing in wintertime, January, when it's really cold, or the end of February, like we're in right now, because it's different. And in January, you focus one area. This time of year, you kind of have two different types of fish in the river, and you need to focus on multiple different areas. And I loved his response to that. So I hope you guys really enjoy this episode. We cover a wide range of topics, like I said, from multiple different species. And I really enjoyed sitting down with a father and son duo that are going out, starting a guide business, and really creating a dream. It's awesome. So today's episode's fun. I hope you like it. If you can, do me a huge favor, guys and girls. The messages and in responses on Facebook seem to have slowed down a little bit. I don't know if everybody's busy and doing things and not spending much time online, which if you are, great. I'd rather you be out catching fish or hunting or whatever it is you like to do than spending time online anyways. But anyways, send me a message. Just tell me what you think about the podcast. Give me any ideas. Tell me what you like, what you don't like, the people you'd like to hear from. You know, if there's any type of species you've wanted to catch and you've tried to and you just haven't been able to figure it out. I get a ton of inspiration from you guys. You guys really are my driving force that keeps me doing this and every week has me searching for new guests to bring on and answer questions that I've had. But I want to know the questions that you guys have. What are you struggling with, or maybe what are some of the things that you've figured out? Share some of those tips and tactics with me too. I'd love to get like a listener's perspective where I can, you know, every week just have messages coming in and say, tip from so-and-so, this is how they were catching fish today, and share that with our community. That would be really awesome. So send in the messages. Love hearing from you guys. Enjoy today's episode and hope to hear from you soon. So this is the first episode that I've actually recorded at my house live with other people. All the ones that I record at my house so far have always been over the phone. I usually always go to someone else's house to do the recording. So I appreciate you guys driving out to see me today. But I guess that's kind of halfway
for you guys. Not bad.
Because you're up in Big Rapids.
Yep, I live up in Big Rapids.
And I guess I'll let you guys go ahead and introduce yourselves before we get too far here.
Sure. My name is Max Werkman. I'm one of the owners and guides at Werkman Outfitters.
Pretty straightforward.
Pretty straightforward, yeah. That's about all I do.
And I'm Tom Werkman. I'm the senior statesman here between Max and I. And, I guide also. I also have a kind of a full-time job as well, too, in the banking industry, but slowly transitioning over into my son and I really getting this up and running into a full-service, full-time guide business.
Okay.
Hopefully that means I don't ever have to have a banking job, but
yeah,
who knows?
I don't know if you ever want a banking job. I don't know, who wakes up in the morning and says, I want to be a banker?
Who wants a job, period?
Yeah, right.
That's right.
That's the nice part about being a fishing guide is basically you're unemployed, but you make a little money on the side.
Well, it's still work, though.
Right.
So how long have you guys been guiding now?
Oh, this will be our third spring.
This will be our third spring with the business.
Yep, third spring. But I mean, we've both been fishing forever.
Okay.
I mean, this is just the professional side of it.
Yeah, ever since you were a little kid. I mean, I remember you walking, basically when you could walk, there was a fishing pole in your hand. And
right.
Whether it be down in Southwest Florida or it be at the neighborhood pond,
mm-hmm.
you know, so fishing, yeah, we've been doing this for quite a long time. Like probably a lot of people on the podcast have been doing for a long time right. too.
And what was what sparked the jump into deciding, you know what, let's start a guide business?
Well, I had I'm also an owner with four other partners in a fishing lodge, and you know, Max had always wanted to be a fishing guide, and so when it came time when he graduated from high school, he wanted to be a guide and got a drift boat, and I said, okay, so do you want to come guide for us? And Max said, well, no, I don't. And I kind of looked at him and I said, well, what do you mean no? And he goes, well, Dad, you have four other partners in that business, and what if they decide to sell?
Yeah.
And I'm left holding the bag, and I don't have any, potentially I couldn't have any job. And
yeah.
So I said, well, okay, well, what do you want to do? Start a guide business.
Basically.
Okay.
Basically.
And so that's how we, you know, that's how we got into it. You know, we decided to just take a leap. We got a drift boat first and realized that we needed to expand just beyond intimate settings because you're kind of tied a little bit with that. And we needed to get into the bigger river systems in West Michigan here. And so then we bought a jet boat. Still remember our first argument that we had is
basically, yeah, who's going to buy the jet boat? Can we buy a jet boat? But
they're not cheap.
No.
No, they're not cheap. Well, let alone what kind of jet boat do you want to get?
Yeah, right? I mean, there's
you want to get a tiller? Do you want to get a forward console?
You want to get aluminum? You want to get a fiberglass? You want to get an 18-foot, a 16-foot?
And let's just say Max won the argument. I didn't have to play. You know, one of the things you get about being a dad is you get to pull the dad trump card every now and then. But, you know, you got to be, when you're a business partner, you got to be careful of doing that from time to time, too. Because he has, in some respects, he has a much, much more extensive knowledge on things than what I do. And, you know, particularly when it comes to gear and equipment. So I kind of defer to him on that. And then on the finances and running the business, he kind of deferred to that to me as well. So
that's the fun part. I mean, you know, we both go back and forth. And being father, kid, you know, I mean, you always have the dad-son relationship. But then we have to work as business partners as well.
Right.
So that's a leap and a gap that most people don't have to deal with or...
I never thought I'd have to be accountable to my son.
No, I didn't.
I spent some time working with my dad growing up, and there's definitely advantages and disadvantages to it. I'll say that.
Yeah.
There's it's easier in a way because you know each other so well, but then sometimes I feel like it's easier to cross some lines and get mad at each other.
But it's harder to, like you said, to hold each other accountable. You know, I mean, he's my dad, so it's like, it's kind of hard to always know you're wrong, Dad, or no, that's not how I want it done, because I've always looked up to him, because, I mean, you know, he's my dad.
Right.
So that's kind of like a weird threshold that we have to
absolutely
deal with.
But, you know, we managed to figure it out and work through it. And,
yeah,
we always, you know, do. It's not like there's a lot to do, but, yeah, we kind of really went back and forth on the jet boat thing. But
and a couple other, you know, small things here and there just in how we want to run our business. But
so I plan to buy a jet boat someday, probably not anytime soon because I just got a drift boat a couple months ago and I'm having lots of fun with that still. But what were some of the things that you thought about when it came to buying a drift boat and what were the reasons that you went with? You have a stealth craft?
Stealth craft, yep. We have two stealth crafts. Biggest reason is they're local.
Yeah.
I mean, I spend a lot of time in Baldwin fishing around in there and just hanging out there a bunch, get to meet a lot of people. And, you know, nice thing about stealth crafts, too, is they're fiberglass. They're super customizable. You know, you can build them how you want to fish. But on the flip side, which is an argument that my dad brought up, is if I'm running down a river and hit a rock going full speed, you know, a fiberglass is much more, you know, prone to breaking, so to say. I mean, if you're running on a flat bottom and you hit a pointy rock, that could poke a hole through it rather than aluminum, you know.
Those things are pretty sturdy, though.
They are really sturdy. They're quite nice boats. Their jet boats move quite well in the water.
Yeah, I've been in a couple now, and I was quite impressed.
Well, that was one of the things, too, and like I said, they're local, so if something does happen, just drive right to Baldwin and fix it.
And fiberglass is easier to repair than aluminum, and they have a plast core interior, which is actually, in some cases, can be stronger than aluminum, and holds the fiberglass
together.
And that's
what floats in those boats. You know, in a regular boat, you have to have flotation in the boat, you know, say like a G3, there's flotation blocks in there.
Okay.
You know, on a fiberglass boat, like the stealth crafts, like their plast core, that's what floats.
Gotcha.
So for a 16-foot boat, you can have almost the same square footage as some 18-foot aluminum boats.
Oh, okay.
Give or take, depending on the boat. But that's what's nice about those boats is our 16-foot jet boat has a lot of square footage in it. And good walk-around capability. Good storage, that kind of stuff.
Cool. You guys still have drift boats too?
Yep, we still have a drift boat. We use that a lot on the White River. Can't guide the Pier Marquette, but fish there a lot for fun. And then sometimes on the Muskegon, depending on water flow, we bring the drift boat, but mainly
primarily on the Grand River. You know, we use the jet boat for that. And then when Max comes back from Alaska, the salmon will be running, and we'll do a short stint on the Muskegon River for the salmon, but then primarily we'll come back either to the White or to the Grand. Mm-hmm. And what a jet boat does is it just allows you access to a lot more water, particularly on the bigger systems.
Yeah.
On the Grand River, the stretches that we fish during the summer is the anywhere from Saranac to Lowell to Ada, and there's not much in between there for boat launches, and so that allows you much more maneuverability and access.
Yeah, long stretches, because I've looked at even floating it in the summer on my kayak and stuff. Mm-hmm. I fish the Grand a lot out of my kayak in the summer, and it's a full day trip from one launch to the other. So having a motor definitely is a huge advantage.
And if you get any wind and you're in a drift boat or a kayak, you're working for it.
I've been on the Grand before where it's flowing so slowly and the wind is blowing so hard in my face that you literally have to paddle down the river to get to the launch. And those can be long, long days on the river.
Yeah. Particularly if you got clients in the boat, if you're having a drift boat or something like that. But you know, it with drift boats, it can be done. You just got to plan accordingly.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Now, you're doing all types of trips, smallmouth and pike and salmon, steelhead.
Ice fishing.
Yeah.
We do ice fishing trips now.
That's actually one thing I kind of want to talk about. I've been meaning to do an ice fishing episode, and I just haven't gotten around to doing one yet, so I do want to touch on that a little bit. But before we get away from the river fishing, do you guys do fly fishing and spin fishing? Do you focus on any particular?
We try to do multiple species, multiple techniques.
Okay.
So we don't want to turn away people from learning how to fish.
Yep.
You know, novice people aren't as comfortable as fly fishing or with fly fishing. So we do a lot of spin fishing gear, a lot of bait gear, you know, that kind of stuff. But yet, if we have someone call in that wants to go fly fishing, totally ready to do it, 100% ready to go.
Okay.
So, and, you know, as a self-employed person, when you get work, you know, you can't pass up the opportunity for work because you don't know when the next trip will come. So that's why we do multiple species, multiple techniques is, you know, self-employed. We just want to run as many trips as we can.
Yeah.
You know, our goal is to connect people to the outdoors through fishing. And however you can meet them at their level to do that, we think that that's important. You know, nowadays, there's so much insulation that's happening with cell phones and social media, and people are becoming more and more disconnected with the outdoors. And so how can we meet them at their level?
Right.
And we don't have to be super technical with fly fishing to meet them at their level, but you know, we can, through the different techniques, we're able to really help them get that connection, and the fish really are the conduit to that.
Mm-hmm.
No, I really like that, and it's got to kind of keep it more fun in a way, too, mm-hmm. because you're always changing things up and doing different things.
I mean, one day you can have a experienced fly fisherman that just wants you to row the boat, and the next day you can have someone who's never caught a steelhead, never fished a river, and like you said, it's just fun. Meet new people, different types of people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. How many ice fishing trips are you guys doing?
We just launched it this year.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So really, we launched it in January.
Yeah, right?
Yeah. But, you know, it was... We've done about a half a dozen trips
say
so
six
far.
Or seven.
Well, that's not bad considering the weather that we've had and stuff.
We got probably... I think we have three or four more coming up before our steelhead season kicks off. So we have a few more in the books, but...
And quite frankly, the phone keeps ringing. We took a couple today with people just inquiring about ice fishing and... You know, the thing with ice fishing is it kind of gets back to the basics. Mm-hmm. And I think for a lot of people, they may have had it as kids or whatever, they kind of grew up maybe doing some ice fishing from time to time, and it comes back to a much more simple time. And I think that's what draws them to it. Let alone what you can do is you can get a bunch of people on the ice, you can cook food,
yep.
and just have a,
and just
have
take
a
it
drink
from there.
Beer and have a good old party.
Right.
Right.
You know, and you're in a heated shanty, mm-hmm. and the wind could be whipping out there, but yet you got, you know...
And you could have some pretty sweet ice fishing days, pike fishing and crappie fishing. I mean,
yeah, I love good days out on the ice.
We took a lady out from
Texas
a couple weeks ago, a week or two ago, and we had like 27 flags go for pike fishing.
Holy cow.
I mean, she's never ice fished before, and we're running around chasing flags, and I mean, it was a great
catching
time.
Catching pikes on the jig and all that.
It was a ton
that.
Of fun.
You know, she was just happy being out there when we picked her. We met her at the boat launch and started walking her out. She couldn't believe that she was walking on ice.
Yeah, she's like, how do you know this is safe? It's
well,
you know, we're out here all the time and we know what the conditions are. But, I mean, she was just amazed by walking on ice.
I think her favorite saying was, I'll be happy if I catch a boot. I mean,
yeah,
this is
right?
so much fun because she's never done it before. And that's what, you know, we're giving her that different connection to the outdoors.
Awesome.
She does a lot of red fishing down mm-hmm. in Texas. She does a lot of that. But yeah,
that's
something that she's never done before. And
what's cool about it. Older lady, just see that smile on her face, have a good time. I mean, that's what it's all about.
How do you guys go about finding customers? What's your strategy?
So we do, you know, in this business, it's very media driven. And so we do a lot of, social media postings. Our website drives a lot of traffic as well. So we've really worked on our website to focus in on certain keywords for search engine optimization. We've built that out. I never thought I would. I've learned so much about search engine optimization. I started from nothing and taught myself and read about it, and then develop this website. But that's really, really our focus. Also too, through some partnerships that we've got going on. We get referrals through the website through some of these partnerships, but it's really media driven and word of mouth. We're starting to get some referrals and repeat customers that mm-hmm. are coming. And that's taken some time to get there. A lot of it has come through, you know, people that we know that want to book trips and mm-hmm. and whatnot. But that's really it. I mean, this, like I said, this business is so media intensive, and it is. You know, we try not to post. You know, you have to do it. But we try not to post a lot of hero shots, but we try to do a representation of what a fishing experience would be. You know, if you go to our Instagram page, you'll see everything from skippies and dinks to, you know, to trophy steelhead mm-hmm. that people are catching.
And we also try to... Anywhere in between.
And anywhere in between. And we also try to tell a story. It's just not about the fish, but you'll see story. You'll see, we're trying to develop a storyboard of, you know, with the ice fishing, there's just some pictures of the shanty at night with the light coming through that just says, you know, we arrive late so we can mm-hmm. leave early, which yep. just says, you know, we're going to stay through the night to get the night.
It's an experience, and that's yeah. all we try to capture.
Yeah,
you
we
know,
try
like
to
you
capture.
Said, it's not about the hero shot, but it's about the course of the day, and you know, seeing an eagle in the tree, or hear the turkeys in the morning, or you know, a nice buck on the side of the river. You know, just every little part about it is stuff that we try to capture too, and
just that whole general experience of being outdoors and never yep. know what you're going to see.
Yep.
The reason we all love it so much.
Mm-hmm. That's exactly what it's about.
Yeah, you know, I think one of my favorite videos on there is A Day in the Life.
Right.
You know, where it kind of starts out in the morning, you know, and it shows this time frame that goes through this video does. Mm-hmm. It starts out at like, you know, 7:30, and then it goes to like 8:15, and it shows these different segments.
Just little clips of throughout the day.
Throughout the day, and it's yep. everything from having lunch to losing
tying
a fish
knots,
to tying knots
the fish and
mm-hmm. you know, and it just gives you this overall experience as to, okay, what's it like to go on a guide trip? And it's not, you're not catching fish all the time every time.
And fish are never a guarantee, and that's the hardest thing to do.
No,
too
not.
Is, you know, I've had more days than not, you know, you float down the river and you don't even touch fish.
Yeah.
You know, but that's steelhead fishing, that's, you know, salmon fishing some days.
Especially steelhead fishing.
You know.
They're migratory. They're here one day and gone the next.
Yep.
It's the hardest thing to relay to a client sometimes. Yeah. They're just not here.
Yeah. Sometimes they are, and they're just not biting.
Right.
Too.
That's the worst when you, like, roll over a hole you fish and you kick, like, 10 of them out and you never hook them out of there.
After you just fished it for 20
yeah,
minutes.
Yeah, exactly. Yep.
It happens to everyone. That's for sure.
You know, it's the same with ice fishing too. You know, if people think you're going to go fish for bluegill or panfish.
I've had days like that in Alaska. I mean, everyone thinks Alaska's a place you're going to go hook 100 fish in 100 minutes. And I mean, I've had days when you just don't catch as many as you want, or you don't catch the size or the numbers or stuff. And
yeah,
it's fishing.
Some days you limit out, and some days you.
Some days it takes me 40 minutes to catch a limit. Some yeah. days I'll catch, you know, a limit in the whole day of fishing. So.
Yeah.
How long did you say you've been guiding up in Alaska?
This will be my fourth summer this year.
Okay.
Went there right out of high school, and it absolutely ruined me.
Yeah.
Absolutely ruined me.
In what way?
I mean, well, we were talking earlier before we started this about, you know, wanting to guide and knowing what did you really want to guide. And, you know, in high school, it sounded sweet to get paid to catch fish.
Yeah.
I mean, that's every fisherman's dream probably is to get
right.
money and catch fish, you know, and realistically, I don't fish on a guide trip because I'm working.
Yeah.
But, you know, I got an opportunity to go to Alaska and did a summer guiding there. And at the end of the season, it's like, yep, this is what I want to do. There's nothing else I would rather do than help someone catch fish.
Yeah.
And it's fun, and I enjoy it a lot. But, yeah, this is my fourth season this year, and it's a nice seasonal job. Really like it. Pays bills.
For sure. I want to jump back to ice fishing real quick.
Mm-hmm.
So something that I always struggle with, especially this time of year in February, is just catching fish.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, a lot of times, in my opinion, like, other than just going out to be outside and have a good time and hang out with your friends and drink some beers, February's tough. Is there anything that you guys have found, or anything that you do to maybe help you put a few more fish on the ice in the middle of February when the bite has just seemed to slow way down?
We were talking a lot about, I don't know, like media won't really play into it, but there's a lot of apps on your phone. Now, it doesn't necessarily help us catch more fish, but what was the app called? It's like the...
Navonics.
Navonics, yep.
Yeah.
And it shows contour lines and stuff on the lakes, and you know, everybody can go look out and see the group of shanties, which doesn't necessarily mean there's going to be a bunch of fish there.
Right. The group's always usually in the same spot.
Yeah, exactly. And like, so I mean, that really helps us, as in we can find drop offs, we can find humps, we can find flats, we can find all these different, you know, things on the bottom that might help us catch a fish. Say we're in an area and it's not working, we'll set tip-ups, you know, on that whole drop-off line. Any, you know, depths will vary, but, I mean, it really helps to use the modern electronics, I mean, tremendously.
Is there, so let's say you're fishing for panfish, bluegill, mm-hmm. crappie, perch. Is there any type of structure or depths or food sources or, like, anything that you guys have ever found that kind of, those fish key in these really cold winter months when?
A lot of times what we'll do is, you know, looking online, you can find, you know, the depths and the contours of the lake, like I said. So, you know, obviously, you know, 2 feet of water is not going to be anything, but a crappie is not really going to be in 30 feet. You know, basically, I always kind of look at, all right, we'll start and say 10 to 12 feet of water, you know, and we'll look for, like, what is it on?
We'll look for any type of structure, like weed lines, rocks, mm-hmm. any type where there can be some type of habitat or structure where they can be on. Typically, the colder it gets, they're going to go a little bit deeper. So you got to find like a thermocline.
And it also just comes down to just drilling a ton of holes.
And just and finding just where they are. That's it.
So not going out, setting the shanty up, and just camping there all day and hoping some fish come by?
No, really, really at the end of the day, what it comes down to is they can, you know, they're not necessarily migratory fish, but they can be there one day and they can move to, you know, 50 feet away and they can be over there. So it really comes down to just drilling a ton of holes, mm-hmm. putting your time in, and just figuring out where they are. And then once you find them, then, you know, then you'd kind of move over there, get the shanty reset up, and then you can start fishing over those holes. Okay. You know, particularly for the panfish, for the you know, larger, like the pike or the walleye or the bass, you know, anytime you can find weed lines, particularly with the pike, you know, you're going to want to fish there, any type of mm-hmm. weed structure. And what we've done is we've set the tip ups, like Max had said, around there or down the break line, but then we'll start jigging for them. A lot of times we're going to use jigs that make noise, because if there are fish in the area, the noise is going to be an attractant for them to kind of come in and check it out, like your rip and wrap.
Yeah.
We've had some real good success on those. You know, Rapala's jig wrap. It doesn't create a lot of noise, but it creates this very sporadic movement. And it creates it when you pull it up, it creates enough vibration in the mm-hmm. water that it can pick that the fish can pick that up on their lateral lines, so they'll come and check that out. But you know, really at the end of the day, you just got to put your time in, get some electronics, yep. and drill a ton of holes and just see what you can find.
Okay. Because you can't find the fish if not out there.
That's true. That is the truth. You can't catch them from the couch.
Nope. Yep.
When you're setting up tip-ups for pike on weed lines, do you set those up on the insides or the outside of the weed lines typically?
Both.
Both.
You want to keep your options open.
Okay.
Once you start to see, you know, try to make a mental note of how you've set those tip-ups up. Set them at varying depths as well, too. You don't want them all at the same depth. And so, you know, make a mental note. So then as those tip-ups start to go off, you're going to kind of get a sense as to where those fish are. And then you'll want to kind of adjust your tip-ups mm-hmm. to that.
You know, it also helps having a bunch of guys out there because, you know, Michigan, you can run 3 rods per person.
Yeah.
It helps having 2, 3, 4 people go out there ice fishing, and we can set a ton of tip-ups.
Yeah, we had 10 people out one day, and we had, like, you know, 20 tip-ups.
We had a ton of tip-ups. Yeah. It's fun chasing flags and doing all that all day. And
you know, the old adage is, if the flag's down, you can drink beer. If it goes up, you better be running.
You better start running. Yeah.
Yeah, I've had some good days out on the ice where it's just flag after flag after flag, and those are the days you go for and you remember forever. Unfortunately, they're not all like that. But.
Yep. And it's fishing, you know. Yeah. Some days they just don't bite.
But what really helps is, you know, if you got a Vexlar or a Hummingbird or any type of electronics where you can watch those fish and see where they mm-hmm. are on the bottom once you get your jig or you get your bait down there, you know, that's really going to be key to having some successful days on the water.
Mm-hmm. Definitely. Sure.
Do you guys get into using like soft plastics at all for panfish, or do you primarily use wax worms and spikes and
mouses? Primarily just use a lot of bait, you know. Yeah. I feel like I get a lot more results on bait, you know, and results is what clients want. Yeah. You know?
I would agree, but more and more I hear people talking about soft plastics and how they can be more productive sometimes, and maybe they are. I've had very limited experience, so I didn't know if that was anything you guys were doing.
It's just like us too. We don't really use too many, you know. Can't say for sure, but you know, bait works, and why switch?
I can tell you one of these days, though, I'm going to stick a wacky worm down the hole and see what happens.
Right.
You know, you never know what's going to happen when you do that.
No, just get off the bottom and just go like that a little bit and see what happens. Those are pretty deadly in the summer. But
we were out in Colorado. Me and some friends went out there, and we met up with one of my buddies that lives out there. And we drove up to a lake he fishes all the time and fished trout. And we were, you know, throwing more traditional things for trout, like spinners and he fishes a lot of tube jigs with rubber tubes on them, and we were catching fish on that. And then my buddy Jacob said, I'm gonna just try throwing on a Cinco. He goes, this is too much like bass fishing, fishing weed lines and stuff. And he started destroying them on those Cincos.
They're probably the most productive bait, soft plastic lure you can use.
Absolutely. If I could fish one soft plastic, it would definitely be a Cinco.
The largest smallmouth I took out of the Grand was with a client, and we hooked up we were just, you know, kind of trying some different things, and we came to it was a hole that was probably about 6-7 feet deep, and I said, here, we're going to try something a little different. And he looked at me and he said, well, what do you mean? You know, we're doing pretty well on the spinner blade. And I said, well, let's just mix it up here a little bit. I just got a feeling. So I hooked up a wacky worm. I put a bullet, sliding bullet on there. And I said, just cast it out there, cast on a 45 degree, you'll feel it hit the bottom, and just let it, you know, kind of just raise it a little bit, let it bounce off the bottom. And he did that a couple times, and on the third try, he pulled up a 23 inch smallmouth bass.
Oh, wow.
That was the largest bass. That was a monster. Just bounced it off the bottom. And so I'm like, okay, we're on some here. But with those, you know, with those larger bass, they're not going to hit it the first time through. You got to get it through a few times. And so, okay, where there's one, you're going to find a few others.
Yeah.
And we pulled up about, a half a dozen more, which was pretty good for that little area right there for that day. Nothing that big, but, you know, some okay size ones. But, those Cincos, they can, if you fish them right, you can't really not fish them right. But
yeah, you can just throw them out there and let them sit for 2 minutes and something will pick one up after it's been sitting there.
Yep, it'll pull it up. And but no, those Cincos are definitely the go-to bait.
Yes. Yeah. Those and the ones that I used to use a lot before I started using those was the Zoom centipedes, which are very similar in action and just a little bit smaller. And those used to be my go-to a lot too, especially for largemouth. Do you guys do any like largemouth or trips like out on the lake in the summer?
No, I'll go down before, because we have a jet boat, I'll go into the bayous, the Spring Lake bayous, but I can only get in there until the weeds start to crop up, because a jet boat's basically a giant vacuum.
Right.
But we've had some real good success with largemouth bass. You know, they're a little different than the smallmouth, but they're still fun to catch, and there's some real good size largemouth that are in there. And the nice part about that is when you're fishing for those, you're going to pick up some real good sized pike down in those bayous. They're just, for some reason, I think the pike seem to be a little bit bigger down in there because there's more biomass for them,
right?
And they're not having to fight current as much. And there
that
was
makes
a
sense.
You know, a few years ago there was a large pike die off in the Lowell section, and
really?
So yeah, the pike are starting to recover from that. So
you know what that was from?
It was from the hard freeze we had that a few winters ago, and they just lack of oxygen in the water.
Gotcha.
So when the ice went out, a bunch of them went belly up, but they're starting to do a nice recovery now up there. But yeah, we tend to fish the bayous a little earlier on.
That's something I haven't done a lot of, is fishing any of those bayous. I hear that there's some pretty fantastic fishing all around for pretty much everything up in some of those. What is it like when you get up in one of those bayous? What's the water depth like, or is it more kind of just like a flood water? It's shallow.
No, it can be, Spring Lake, it's got, if you're in Spring Lake, you get some pretty good depth. Some of the bayous you're going to get, you can get into 20, 25 feet in some of the sections. But for the most part, there's contour, there's elevation changes. Depending on what bayou you're in, you're going to find flats, a lot of weeds. Yep. And that's real good habitat for the bait. You're going to get some incidental catches along the way. With your targeting, you may pick up a sheep's head or a catfish or a bullhead. Oh, okay. Or
they
something.
They come up mm-hmm. out of the lake.
Oh, yeah.
Or the big lake in
yep.
there.
Yep. You may pick up some of those in there. But for the most part, you're going to get, you're going to pick up the bass, the pike. You'll get some walleye in there as well, too. I had a gar pike on one time. Thank God that thing got off. I don't want to mess with its teeth.
But, I've always wanted to catch one. I see a ton of them when I'm smallmouth fishing in the Grand. Mm-hmm. I've had them come and, slash at whatever I'm using, but they can never seem to get hooked in their tiny, skinny little mouths.
Yeah, they kind of grab the... we was an X-Wraps, and it came up and just kind of grabbed it in between the hooks.
Okay.
And so
Pretty good chance of hooking it then.
And it took off, and so it had in its mouth, and it just spit it out at that point. It came up to the boat. But, yeah, they've got, they're a cool-looking fish. They got some cool spots on them. I think they take some pretty cool pictures.
Yeah.
With it, but yeah, you'll get those incidental catches from time to time, and that can be fun in and of itself. What we want to do is more on the calm days then. We want to move towards kind of the near shore fishery. It's mm-hmm. a little hard in a jet boat, but, at some point here, we're probably going to get another boat and capture mm-hmm. that a little bit more. There's all kinds of, with the quagga mussels in Lake Michigan, you've got all the nutrients are staying near shore because the zebra mussels have died off. The quagga mussels can't really live in the near shore marine environment because it's so warm, but they'll go further out. So you've got all the nutrients coming near shore. And what that means is then all the bait fish are going to be near shore, your gobies, mm-hmm. your alewives. And what we're starting to see is, supersized muskie, supersized walleye, supersized smallmouth bass.
Awesome. As a kid fishing the piers, the early mid-spring, there are some huge walleyes out there.
Supersized.
I caught some huge walleyes off the piers before.
Yeah, and it's not quite like Saginaw Bay, but it's a really good fishery.
But it's unique to West Michigan.
Yeah.
I think the tough part about fishing Lake Michigan for many species of fish is just the lack of structure in places to mm-hmm. pinpoint where fish can be. Because, you can troll out there for hours and never come across anything that's significant in terms of structure on the bottom.
Thermal climb comes in. And when I was younger, I used to spend a lot of time. I used to run charters out at Lake Michigan, first mate kind of thing.
Okay.
And that's what you look for. Temperature, cold weather fish. They're cold water fish, like cold water.
Yeah.
The warmer it is, the farther out you have to go, kind of thing. But like I said, that's what we're looking forward to is us.
But you're talking about fishing more of the warm water species that stay in closer to the shore.
Yeah, they stay in closer to shore, and there are some reefs out there. They aren't like a lot, but there are reefs out there, and then you can get, and they're going to move around. They'll move around the pier heads. They'll stay on the near shore. So any place you can find any type of structure, whether it be just a small amount of structure, you're going to start to find some of those larger fish around that structure. And so you've just got to put your time in out there to, to figure out where that is. It's something that we haven't really begun exploring, really been fishing for yet, but it's something we're going to start to explore for because I think there's an opportunity there for you know, to develop that fishery as well too. We do it a little bit, you know, we'll go along the rocks and the piers and stuff like that. And
you know, we'll see a lot of good fish, smallmouth and walleye and stuff out there on the clear days. I've always wanted to go out there on a clear day and just go snorkeling and swimming through there and see what kind of fish you can find down in those rocks and stuff.
You know, there's some stuff off of Holland. You know, you got to go down to Saugatuck where there's some reefs down there where people perch fish. There's some out in Holland.
Some out in Port Sheldon.
Yep, some out in Port Sheldon. So you've got to find those areas and really, you know, start to focus on catching those fish in those areas.
That'd be a lot of fun. You said there's some muskie out there too?
Oh yeah, there's some muskie out there.
I've known a couple people. I mean, they're few and far between.
Right.
You know, but we've seen muskie come out of the lake, not like, you know, lake connecting to the big lake, but I've seen plenty of muskie come out of the big lake,
Particularly if you fish the drowned river mouths, right around in those areas, around the pier heads and stuff, they move in and
out.
When
the lake flips over, you get like an east wind, you get an east wind, that cold water comes close to shore, the bait comes in, muskies, walleyes, that kind of stuff.
Yeah, I feel like there's got to be so many fish out there that people just don't target and don't catch out in Lake Michigan just because it's kind of overwhelming to try to figure out where to go and find them. But
and you know, and everybody wants to, you know, during the summer months, they want to take the charter boat, they want to go out there, and they want to, you know, they want to catch the Chinook, or they want to catch, you know, a steelhead or something along those lines, but. You know, to your point, there's a whole nother fishery that's out there, and I think if somebody's looking to be, you know, a complete angler and really looking to, you know, try something new and different, you know, there's the whole warm water species, I think, which is really starting to take off. Mm-hmm. I mean, people are looking at, you know, pike and bass as, you know, they've always been a game fish, but I think they're starting to get much more respect within the angling community, and particularly with customers who want to go out and fish for those, and they want to learn new techniques on how to do that. You know, carp is a big up and coming one. They're a cousin to the bonefish. We don't really fish for those, but you know, you can sight fish for them, and you know, they're a freight train when you get one of those on. And then this, you know, the smallmouth bass, there's a reason why the good Lord didn't create a 10-pound smallmouth.
no one would ever be able
no one ever be able to pull it in. And they, you know, I mean, this is just my own personal opinion, and others on the show or listeners may disagree, but you know, I'd rather, and this is just, again, me personally, I would rather catch a smallmouth day in and day out over a trout. I know Max would disagree with me.
I disagree 100%. I prefer trout fishing way over smallmouth fishing.
I think, I kind of agree with both of you. And I grew up smallmouth fishing, and it wasn't until later in my life that I got into trout fishing, and I do a lot more trout fishing now, just because it's newer to me, and I'm still learning a lot. And not to say I couldn't learn a lot of smallmouth fishing still, but I think I have a lot more to learn on the trout side. So it's more interesting to me. But most trout I catch anymore, at least, because I have gotten to the point where I can catch a pretty decent number of them, especially in the summer months when it's still cool enough where they're feeding actively and stuff, that, you know, only maybe 1 out of 10 of those fish I get really excited about. Man, I don't care what size smallmouth you have on. Every single fish, me and my cousin Dustin go kayak fishing all the time, and we always laugh because I got one. Oh, it's a good one.
Yeah.
Oh, no, it's not. It's just a little one. Because they all fight like they're a good one. Every single one of them is excited.
Well, that's what I like about how we run things is I love trout, and he loves bass. You know, and he has his strong suits, and I have my strong suits, and you know, I'm not knocking the smallmouth guys because they're cool fish and they're fun to catch, but I'm a trout guy.
And I think that's, you know, in this business too, I think you've got to, you know, if you're a guide, you got to kind of carve out a niche to be successful. And you know, there's a lot of real good trout guides out there. There's a lot of real good smallmouth guides out there, and pike and so on and so forth. And, you know, and you know, people have asked me in the past, well, what's your favorite fish? And I really can't tell them what that is.
Whatever I'm fishing for that day.
Whatever, exactly. Whatever happens to be that I'm fishing for.
I know my favorite fish, and that's Alaskan rainbow trout. I love Alaskan trout.
That's a fair statement, I think, because it, just from what I've seen in videos, at least, and what I know from catching rainbow trout and steelhead, those things go nuts.
The 30-inch rainbow is a very special thing.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
It's some cool stuff. They don't fight like smallmouth, I'll tell you that, but...
They fight more than a smallmouth.
But,
yeah. You know, and trout, you know, they got their own they got their own unique challenge to catch. Yep. And, you know, and I think what people miss too on the bass side is that bass can be just as finicky.
They can. They definitely can. And well, I think bass can be more finicky as in, you know, vast majority of time. Now, you have river smallmouth and you have lake smallmouth, but like, let's say lake smallmouth, you know, he can sit there and look at that thing for so long, you know, and a trout, that thing's always coming by him. You can give him, I feel like you can get a trout to react more, you know, because they're in a river.
Yeah.
And I feel like bass can sometimes be a lot harder to catch than a trout.
I would agree with that. A lot of times with trout, a lot of times when I'm fishing in the summer, if I'm fishing really small creeks and stuff and I'm using spin tackle, I'm trying to just let them see that presentation for just the shortest period of time. Fast presentations, you know, don't give them a lot of time to see it and make them make that split second decision where they got to come out and nail it.
Yeah.
Because if you have a really long, slow retrieve, I feel like a lot of times they wise up to it. Mm-hmm. And where, like, fishing in the Grand with bass, like, typically they do have a long time to take a look at it and they can back up. They're not tucked up in that one little corner where they're out of the current. They're hanging out in the whole river sometimes behind multiple rocks and tons of log jams.
So I feel like smallmouth are more opportunistic. I mean, trout are opportunistic too, but I feel like, you know, brown trout's got his home, his little spot. You know, he feeds on this. This is what he does. You know, I mean, point proven, when you got smallmouth fishing, you catch a lot more smallmouth than you catch when you go out trout fishing. You know?
Typically.
Yeah. You know, when you go out trout fishing, you're not going to go catch 16 trout in a day, but when you go out smallmouth fishing, you can dang well catch 16 smallmouth in a day.
Yeah, absolutely. I don't know, man. It's tough. Like I said, it kind of depends on what I'm fishing for that day, because there's been plenty of days where I'm out on the Grand and I'm catching just tons of smallmouth and thinking this is the greatest thing ever.
Yeah.
And then same thing when I go trout fishing and I catch four trout in a day. I'm like, this is the greatest thing ever.
I like it when I go steelhead fishing in the spring in the Grand. I catch smallmouth and beads.
That is fun. I've done that just a couple times.
It takes you by surprise.
Or you're on the white and you catch a walleye on a bead.
Or you catch a walleye. Yep, exactly.
One of the biggest walleye I ever caught was on the white.
Those are some of the biggest walleye I've seen too.
Bead and fly, actually, I think.
You know, those are all the lake run walleye that are coming up.
Yeah,
you know,
those are. That'll be starting spawning real soon. Actually, season's going to close real soon.
Yeah,
I've heard if you can get out there
20
like
days,
depending on the weather, like right at the end of the season.
It depends on that river. They're going to either run before or after season.
Someone's going to send me some nasty messages for you.
I really hope they run before season. I'd love to go steelhead fishing and catch a little bit of walleye instead.
I don't mind catching them.
No. Problem with that river is, you know, those are, I mean, you have a potential for a 30-inch walleye.
Yeah.
You know, those are breeder walleye. I hate to say it, but we got to let those go.
Oh, yeah.
You know, you get a 30-inch female.
I just don't like cleaning fish that big.
I'm with you, man. I clean too many fish in Alaska ever and
but also
want to clean them here.
Also, too, those walleyes when they're that big, the meat's not going to be as good.
It's too thick and it's too, it's not that it's mushier. I think if you, like, filleted the fillets into thinner fillets or something, it would be better. But once
like
they get over that, like,
it
2-inch thick, I don't know. They're just too thick for me.
They don't fry as easy.
Yeah, they don't cook all the way through, and then, like, the outside's too cooked. And I like those nice little, like, well, depending on where you're at, but, like, 13 to, like, 17-inch fish. Those are the ones I like to bring home.
It's a lot of the walleye we've caught nowadays. That 17 to 19 inch is what we keep. And anything over, we'll let go. Or, you know, some lakes you can only keep them 14 or 15 above. So, you really got to be paying attention.
Yeah, I think over on Saginaw, you can keep them at 13 or something.
Yeah, I think some of the other inland lakes, it's like 14 or 15.
I think most are 14.
A lot of the lakes we fish, you know, I think they're at 14 or 15.
Yeah. I'm all out of fish. My buddy Kevin took us over. Must have been November. We went over and jigged walleye and brought a bunch home. And
where'd you go, to Saginaw Bay?
Yeah, in the river.
I've never been to Saginaw before I fish. I'd love to do it.
I've been over there a few times, and the first couple times where I was going, what are people talking about? And last time we went over there and we sat in the boat all day long and just caught walleye after walleye
I love that.
Yeah, and we didn't catch any real big ones, maybe a couple that were like 3-4 pounds, mm-hmm. but they're all like perfect eating size. And we probably sorted through a couple hundred fish, and we all brought a limit home. And
it was just that's better than some of the nights I've had on lakes around here. I took him out on one of the lakes around where I live, and he sat all night looking at a screen, didn't even mark a single walleye.
No, you just have those nights and days, you know.
There's of course, I caught one on the tip up, but yeah. He and I sat in Cheney for like hours, and he's like, "So, what's a walleye mark look like in this lake?" It's like, "Well, it looks like this and this," and he just sits there all night doing this all night, and he never caught a single fish.
I got tennis elbow from that, but. Even guys get skunked, you know. It just depends on a lot of things, but
absolutely.
Yeah.
Yep. I feel like half the clients that I take out are better fishermen than me. Like, I'll take people out and, you know, we'll go steelhead fishing, and I've never caught a steelhead before, and they catch 5. I'll fish damn near all of December and not even catch one. And it's just
like, those are the guys you want or girls to catch 5 though, because man,
my girlfriend caught more trout bigger than 28 this year than I did in Alaska. I mean, she goes to Alaska with me, and you know, yeah, I'm rowing the boat, you know, I'm doing the work, but she caught way more trout that were big than mine.
My wife doesn't fish with me very often, but when she does, she typically outfishes me. And
that's how it goes.
I think women are better fishermen than
men. I think they are too. Women are much more patient than men.
Women are actually like statistically proven to be a better shot than men with guns or archery.
Yeah.
Because they have a lower men are just
resting
always,
heart rate.
I'm the best. I'm going to do this. I'm the greatest. I can do this all. And then
ego gets in the way.
And they just think they have this image in their mind that they can do it. And the women are always like, well, how do I do it? You know, like they're much more leaned back. And
my wife's more worried about the snacks than catching the fish. But then because she's worried about the snacks, that she ends up catching
my girlfriend's
fish.
More worried about if someone's dog's going to be on the river to look at the dog or something.
That's
more
what
she cares about.
My wife, she brings a book and sits back in the chair, and she'll just set a rod down and just wait for something to pick it up. And a lot of the times she's actually went fishing with me. She's been down in Florida, and one time she caught a black drum. It was just huge, like this.
Yeah.
You know, that's the thing. When you're paying the least amount of attention, you know, which a lot of times they do, that's when you catch biggest fish.
And then last year when we were down in Panama, you know, I've always wanted to go peacock bass fishing. She's like, I don't really care if I go. You can go without me. You're going to be out there all day. And I'm like, no, just come with me.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I speak very, very little Spanish, and she speaks twice as much as I do, and we're going with a guy that doesn't speak any English, so I'm kind of thinking, like, I wouldn't mind maybe trying to translate a little bit.
That's hard. I've had guide people from France that don't speak a lick of English, and it's just it's awful. It's so hard, that language barrier. It's sign language, and you're pointing at it, and like, you know,
tie knot.
Well, the people that I've guided from France have been to, it's in Alaska. And
I'm surprised people from France don't speak, like, perfect English.
Right? I don't know. I've had to guide people all over from, I mean, in Alaska, you never know where you're going to get people. We have a week of people who come from England that swing fly specifically for kinks, all they do. And I've tons, I mean, you name it, you know, I've probably guided people from there. And
really?
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
That would be fun. I wish I would have got into that when I was younger, back before I had.
It's a hell of an experience when you're 18 and you're responsible for people's lives. I mean, a bear can get you, you know.
Like that, and then you had the wolf situation.
I mean, I personally have never seen a wolf before, but I mean, there's people that work with me there that have been chased off gravel bars by a pack of wolves.
Really?
I mean, yeah, I've been.
Well, and you're probably on some pretty serious rivers.
Yeah,
too,
we
you gotta be careful.
If anyone knows, I guide in Katmai National Park on the Naknek River. So it's one of the five are one of the biggest sockeye rivers. You know, we get on average 2 million sockeye a year. And that's just sockeye. That's not kings, cohos, chums, pinks, rainbows, char, grayling. I mean, there's a ton of fish in that river, and I think it's the coolest river I've ever seen by far.
Yeah.
I mean, in the Midwest, you know, these aren't wild fish here. You know, all the kings, all the steelhead, all the cohos came from a pen at one point.
Sure.
It's really cool to fish a river that 200 years ago, this is exactly what these fish do. 300 years ago, this is exactly what these fish did. It's just pretty cool to be a part of that environment.
Yeah, man. Alaska is a place that I have to get to someday and do some fishing.
That's cool. It's so cool. Yeah. I mean, just being in Alaska.
Yeah.
The vastness of it, you know.
How far, like, offshore are you fishing?
So the Naknek starts at Naknek Lake. It's like the second or third largest inland lake in Alaska. I think it's the second next to Iliamna. And then from the lake mouth where it turns in the river, I think we're roughly 50 miles from the ocean.
Okay.
And then, but there's only, I'd say, 16 miles of fishable river. So we have a lot of the uppers, a lot of gravel bars and nice runs and stuff. And then you get down lower, it just turns into tidewater, you know, not really structure for salmon to spawn on or anything.
Like the tide from the ocean actually mm-hmm. still comes yep. up into
we
there.
We still see the tide 30, 40 miles upriver.
Wow. I mean,
we still get affected by that.
Wow. You must have some pretty serious
it is. It is the gnarliest piece of water I've ever fished. Huh. I mean, you think of downtown Grand Rapids, and the Naknek is probably 2 to 3 times the size of that.
And you would imagine being in Grand Rapids and having tidal waters push up.
I mean, I couldn't tell you.
But what's CFS. The average? What would you say the average flow of the Naknek? 30,000?
I couldn't even tell you.
Oh, really?
I couldn't even say. I mean, there's some wave trains that there's boulders as big as this room, bigger. I mean, there's a spot that. And there's rocks bigger than cars. I've seen boats die in that river before. I mean, it's some gnarly water, but fishing makes it worth it.
Have you ever had any sketchy experiences yourself?
Crossing the lake. So across the lake, there's Brooks Park, Brooks Nash, whatever you call it. You ever like see on National Geographic the sand or the bear standing on the waterfall, open his mouth? Yep. Yeah, that's most likely Brooks.
Okay.
We do like a 50, 60 mile run. I think that's what I don't know the exact distance, but we do a run across the lake. I mean, I've been in 10 footers in that lake before.
In a flat bottom boat.
And
that's rough.
I've been in like fives in a flat bottom. Which is, I mean, you go up a wave, you cavitate, motor stalls, you go down, you take a 4-footer over the bow. I mean, it's, I've been in some stupid stuff, but it's cool.
Yeah, that's scary.
I've seen people hit rocks and get ejected out of boats. I mean, I've seen boats spin out and people get thrown out of them. I mean, I've seen wolves chase people off gravel bars. I've been me to you away from a bears before. I mean, that's a cool place.
That sounds like an awesome, awesome time.
You know, that's the thing with this business is you're not going to make much of a living. I mean, you can, but you're not going to make much of a living, but you're going to have one heck of a life.
Might not make much of a living, but you're really going to live.
The conditions, really we don't live in the nicest conditions.
You're going to have a heck of a life, and the stories you can tell.
We live in the bush up there. I mean, it's not nice like your house here, you know.
I think that's what most people fish and hunt and go outdoors for is those experiences. Right. It's not the nice comfy couch to sit on with the 50-inch TV.
I mean, I live in a wall
that's
tent.
That's not living.
I live in a canvas wall tent 4 months out of the year.
You know, I think a lot of people don't, for some reason or other, they don't dare to take a step and to try something like that or to get out and to have a little bit of adventure. And you can always tell because I'll go to, you know, I'll be out and about or whatever and people ask me what I do and I'll say, well, you know, I'm a banker by day and I'm a fishing guide by night. And they're like, oh my gosh, tell me about your fishing guide. Tell me about that. It's like,
they didn't ask you about banker.
Right? Oh my gosh, you're a banker? Tell me about that. Oh my gosh, you must live on the edge.
Well, they say like, what's a fishing guide? It's like, well, people pay me to take them fishing. People pay you to take them fishing? Like,
yeah, they do.
A lot of people can't wrap their heads around it.
I'll be honest, I had no idea that was even a thing growing up.
It's a profession.
I grew up in Coldwater, Michigan, which is the most southern part, and there's no salmon.
Basically,
trout fishing.
Indiana.
Yeah, exactly. Basically, Indiana. Luckily, it wasn't. But sorry, Indiana people that are listening. I'm just kidding. But you are terrible drivers. But yeah, I mean, it was bass fishing and pike fishing and panfish and the whole.
Well, that's where you cut your teeth as a fisherman.
Charter fishing and steelhead fishing. I didn't get exposed to that until, you know, much later in life, and realizing there's actually an opportunity to do something like be a guide.
Right.
So that's cool that you guys have started this adventure together. Yeah.
That's cool being 21. I mean, most kids my age still go to school, live at home, you know, work a crappy job. No offense, you know, some people just do like that.
That's what you got to do at that stage in life.
I'm fortunate enough that I get to do what I like to do at my age.
You know, and ultimately when you're a dad or a mom or whatever, and when your kids turn 18, it's kind of like, okay, you know, see you later, you're out in the real world. Or when they graduate from college, see you later, you're out in the real world, and they kind of go do their thing. And, I didn't want that for our relationship. I wanted it to be for us to really weave a thread through our life. And fishing has always been that thread. Yeah. And to be able to stay connected. I mean, we talk maybe not every day, but almost every day.
We
about
talk a lot.
Something about what's going on within the business. And
or just fishing.
Or just fishing. You know, hey, how'd you do? You know, we text one another or whatever. And I think, that's ultimately what...
gives you a good reason to stay connected and have something in common more than
what you've been up to.
Because even just, you know, my good friends that I've grown up with and I still see regularly, it's like you don't talk to them that much because there's really not that much of a reason to talk. You're doing the same thing every day. So working together is a great way to have much more in common and to stay connected. So that's really cool.
And the stories I think we can tell, I mean, everything from, you know, we did that ice fishing guide trip, you know, it was a lot of work. We both of us needed to do it to get it done. And just to be able to say, you know, walk away and say, wow, we had fun together. And we neither one of us had to tell each other what to do. Yep. We just knew what needed to be done and we worked well together.
Yep.
And we can tell that story. And then we can tell the story of that time we were on the White River and you landed that steelhead and I had to jump
off. I made him fall in the river.
I had to jump on the ice shelf, on the shelf ice and fell in the river and we're an hour and a half from the boat launch. But you landed this huge steelhead and it was just,
fish together all the time, and it's funny when we go fish together because it's not a father son; it's a buddy relationship. And I talk a lot of shit to him, and he talks a lot of shit to me,
and all that stuff.
I get pissed at him when he throws in the tree and makes a bad cast. But at the end of the day,
I tell him, "Watch out! Don't hit that rock with the boat."
Yeah, he yells at me for driving the boat or whatever. But
it's all good.
It's all good fun. And,
well, that's half the fun of fishing with buddies or family members is giving each other shit and yelling at each other. And
I feel like if someone out there listening got to fish with me and him together, they would just laugh because we talk to so much smack to each other. But that's all in good.
That's
fun.
What makes it fun. Usually the best laughs of the day come out of those, you know, banterings of back and forth where somebody finally says something that you both just lose it and start cracking up.
I can think of a million things when you and I have gone fishing in the past to do that.
Well, we were on that for that when the ice fishing trip, we're going back and forth, and the one lady says, "God, you sound like my mom and I." And we go, "Really?" He goes, "Yeah, she and I own a business together. We sound the same way, you know." And it's fun. I wouldn't have it any other way.
No, I did make him jump in the river for a fish once, though.
Yeah.
I mean, it was ice flowing down the river.
Was it worth it? Was it big enough fish?
For me, personally, I caught a fish that day. It was great, but he was soaking wet.
That was probably
cold,
a 16, 17-pound
steelhead. That was a big steelhead.
That's a jump in the river fish.
Yeah, double strike.
Catch it, get out of here, go home.
Double strike. We had, it was ice coming down, and ice got wrapped around my line, so I jumped out of the boat, and I had waders on, so I'm doing this around, and it's running down river, and I'm like, get out of the boat, Dad.
And I just had bibs on.
We got to go. We got to net this fish. Get out of the boat.
That's why I always wear waders.
And he jumped out of the river, because I jumped on the shelf ice, and I weigh, like, you know, 130 pounds. I mean, I weigh nothing. So I'm walking on the shelf ice, and I'm like, jump out of the boat, Dad. And Dad jumps out of the boat, sinks to his waist immediately, and through, like, busts through the ice, goes right to his waist in water.
Yeah,
but it was a good fish.
But you know, those are the stories you remember. It's not when things go well.
Oh, wow. Yeah, that's a beauty.
And like there, I mean, river's frozen. You know? Oh,
yeah, it is.
But
you know, the things you remember are when things don't go well versus when it does go well. It's like you always, you don't necessarily remember all the fish you caught.
Well,
but you definitely,
we were talking about Steve Rinella earlier, and he quoted, he says, you know, you all, like, in the moment when it's fun, you never act. I mean, you remember it, but he put, it's like a roller coaster. You don't ever remember back 10 years ago, man, you remember how fun that roller coaster was? But in that episode he was doing it, he was hunting on the mountain, and it was just blowing nasty, crappy weather. Nobody was having fun. But 10 years from there, you think, man, we had so much fun.
That's
sitting on the side
of
there.
That's what you tell stories about.
It's exactly what it is.
It's not the fish that you catch, but the ones that get away.
Mm-hmm.
just like girlfriends. You don't remember the ones you had, but you sure remember the ones that got away.
Yep.
They don't remember you, though.
They sure don't remember me, but I remember
them.
That's
the problem.
That's right.
So one more thing I wanted to try to pick your brain on and get some of your guide knowledge is, in the middle of winter when you guys go steelhead fishing, what type of water are you looking for those fish to be sitting in? Because, man, I'll tell you what, I've heard, like, look for the slow slack water, the really deep pools, and sometimes I'll find them there. But then sometimes they're like right at the top of the run in the fast water, right in the middle of winter.
Well, it depends on what winter you're talking about. Are you talking like right now?
Yeah, like...
Like as in end of February, or are you talking like middle of January winter? Because they'll sit in different water in that time frame.
Okay. I guess maybe elaborate on those two different scenarios.
So right now, I floated yesterday, and...
You floated Sunday?
Saturday.
Okay.
Sorry, I
was going to say, man, you are nuts.
I'm a fishing guy, man. I basically don't really work fish whatever I want, but we floated Saturday, and they're making reds. They're spawning right now. The initial wave.
I thought I was seeing the same thing.
The initial wave, late, you know, your summer run, your September run steelhead.
Those fish that just can't
spawning
wait anymore.
Right now. And those fish are going to be sitting in spawning water, and those riffly little 2, 3, 4, 5 foot runs, you know, that choppy head of the run water. You know, your winter fish that came in last week, they're going to be in your 6, 7, 8 foot holes, slow water, inside of bends, you know, your slower stuff right now.
Okay.
And this time of year is a fun time of year to fish, because you can fish your spring water and your winter water and pick up fish in both.
And that's, see, so I was getting a little confused last week, because I've been steelhead fishing for about 5 years now, so I'm not the most experienced at it, and up until this year I didn't have a boat.
Yep.
So I was doing a lot of shore fishing. You don't see that much water.
Yep.
So you just fish the holes that you can get to, and if you don't catch them, you go home.
Yep.
And now, like, I was out Saturday too, and I was seeing fresh, you know, turned over gravel.
Yeah,
and I'm like, this looks like these fish have been working this gravel. And it seemed like all of the fish that we hooked were in those, like, tighter pinch points at the top of, you know, the faster, where you got a faster run coming into a deeper hole, where they'd be sitting, you know, waiting to get up on that gravel and go polish it up and then drop back in.
And I feel like a lot of the fish that are, you know, they're steelhead. They're weird creatures.
Yeah, they are.
They do some weird stuff. You know, you never can actually know what a steelhead's going to be doing. You know, the fish that we caught, now, we only hooked one on Saturday. And it was in a little 4 foot bucket behind a gravel hump. You know, hook them, quick run, gone.
Yeah.
The day before, on Friday, we hooked 5. Landed like 3 or whatever. And those were all in winter spots. But that one on Saturday is in a spring spot.
Okay.
I mean, so basically my answer is, you know, when you're fishing a late winter, you're fishing your spring and your winter spots.
So you got to hit all the spots.
Because those early push fish have been in the system for months, you know, yep. And they, Mother Nature calls, they got to do their thing. But if you're talking your winter fishing, your January fishing, you're definitely going to be fishing slow, deep water.
Okay.
Definitely.
Just that makes sense.
I mean, there's not much to eat that time of year. Those fish can't expend much energy because they have to eat a bunch, but it's cold. They're just going to be sitting on the bottom, you know, in a slow pool on the tailouts, back of the runs.
Okay.
And that's where you're going to be looking in your winter time spots.
What, when you are fishing those winter fish that are in those deep holes and it's cold, what type of presentations are you using to try to entice them to
give you, know, on a guide trip, I like bead fishing a lot. Beads are, you know, trout is programmed to eat eggs. Trout will always eat eggs. You know, in January, nothing.
Even when there's no eggs around.
Well, you know, if you're fishing a spawn bag in January or a bead or an egg fly and you're still catching fish on it, but there's nothing spawning.
Right.
You know, trout are programmed to eat eggs, and I love fishing beads, eggs, whatever. Wax worms, nymphs are a really good way to catch them too. Just like I said, there's nothing spawning. There's a lot of nymphs floating around, but I always like to mix it up, you know.
Yep.
You never know what a steelhead's going to eat, you know. And when we're fishing, I just love to throw a lot of different stuff. Plugs, you know, aggressive. You're looking for an aggressive biter, you know. Just on a guide trip, I like to throw a lot of things. Really dial in on what those fish are eating.
Yeah.
Switching beads, switching nymphs, switching jigs, switching plugs.
Do you do much plugging?
I really don't that much. I like to incorporate it just for something different.
Yeah.
You know, if people are really struggling on line management, mending, you know, getting a float straight up and down, hey, just watch this rod. And when it's going nuts, grab the rod.
Yeah.
You know, but a lot of clients don't like to sit because it's cold. They like to be interactive and moving around and stuff. And
I mean, I would prefer to catch them floating or something, any day.
It's a much more connective thing.
Well, I went fishing with Roger Hinchcliffe earlier this year, and we had four plug rods going all day, and then there's three of us on the boat, and then two of us were pinning off off either side all day. We were throwing jigs and spawn.
And Roger's
and beads
really good fisherman.
And you know, we were drifting everything. Not one hit all day long on the beads or the jigs or the spawn of any color that we threw.
Yep.
Caught two fish, both of them were on plugs.
And you know, you'll never know until you run it.
Yeah.
You know, you can fish your same colors all day and not catch anything, but you could do, like you said, like if you fish a plug, that could be the difference between zero and one fish.
Yep.
And for a client, that could make the difference.
Yeah, because if, I mean, I know for myself, if I bring one fish into the boat, it's like, oh, that was worth
especially
it.
Especially steelhead
fishing.
Even
though I never go home and I'm like, dang it, I wish I wouldn't have went fishing today, even when I get skunked.
Right.
I never wish that, but like if you just get that one, then you're like,
and that's what I try to tell him. I'm like, I always set my, I mean, you know, personal fishing, I always set my expectations so low. You know, when I'm steelhead fishing, I set my expectations really low, and I'm going fishing no matter what.
Yep.
And that way, if I catch one, I'm like, heck yeah, man, it was a good day. But if I set my expectations as I'm going to go out and go catch five, and I catch none, it's like, wow, today sucked. And a day fishing never sucks because you're out fishing.
Yeah. I've almost stopped setting expectations.
Mm-hmm.
I don't set, like, oh, this is going to be a great day. Or, man, it's probably not worth it to go today, but we'll go anyway. I try not to do either one of those. I try to just go out and focus on what I can do to catch a fish.
Mm-hmm.
And that's changing things up and trying different water and trying different depths and different types of holes, gravel, sand. You know, just what can I do? How can I figure out where these fish are? And I feel like that works better for me.
Mm-hmm.
But then also there's something to be said for being confident and saying, I'm going out there to catch fish today.
I think my confidence goes up a lot more in the fall and the spring because the winter time is is anybody's guess. Yeah. I mean, the winter time is a very tough fishery for steelhead.
Yeah.
Especially this winter when we've had polar vortexes and crazy months and stuff
like
that.
It's been a crazy ups and
it's been a crazy winter this year.
And that's why we go ice fishing.
That's
right.
You want to know something sad? I haven't been ice fishing one time this year.
Really?
And it's been the first time in, I think about 4 years ago I didn't go once, but we didn't. I think that was the year we almost didn't have any ice down here. But yeah, it's either been negative degrees, I have something going on with friends or family, or we have no ice. Those have been my week. I could have went last weekend, to be fair, but I've got the drift boat now, and it was 40 degrees, and it's hard not
personally,
to go out and catch some steelhead.
I would rather freeze with the potential of catching a 10-pound steelhead
the same way.
Now, I don't eat steelhead, and I like watching them let go. Just like
I eat
people.
A couple every year.
You know, I got nothing wrong with that. My personal choice, I let them go.
I think they're better than salmon as well.
I think they're better than salmon. But, you know, I'd rather eat a bluegill than a steelhead, but I'd rather catch a steelhead than a bluegill.
Depends on how I'm cooking them.
There's something about being in a heated shanty. At 50
feeling
years
your fingers,
old,
feeling
my
fingers.
I mean, I'll go out every now and then and that stuff.
Not
don't get me wrong, I don't mind it. But you know, you get the heater running
there's
in a
benefits
shanty.
Benefits and you know drawbacks to both.
I'm pretty lucky. My hands stay pretty warm. I'm pretty lucky. Like I had just some fingerless wool like first light gloves on that are pretty thin. I fished with those all day. Granted, I was rowing the boat all day too, so I stayed
pretty
warm.
Make or break it if you're rowing the boat.
Yeah,
or not.
If you're rowing the boat, you're staying warm, but. My buddy texted me, my buddy Joe that we were fishing with, and he said, man, I'm just starting to get a feeling back in my fingers. I was like, dude, are you kidding me?
I've had it. Basically, I think I've done some nerve damage over the years with how cold it's been with steelhead fishing.
I don't get that bad. My girlfriend she went with us on Saturday, and sitting in the boat like this after like half the day, like, okay, I'm done. I'm so cold.
Yeah. Yeah, it's not for everyone, that's for sure. No. You gotta really like to catch fish to wanna sit in a boat in the cold.
Well,
rain.
Our car didn't even get spotted, so we got to the takeout, our car wasn't even there, so we were kinda stuck for a while there fishing, but
well, on Saturday when I went, I'm not gonna mention what river I was on or who spotted us because they ended up actually taking care of it and I don't want any negative press to come of this.
Yep, I hear ya.
But we got to our car and our key wasn't there.
Oh, that's nice. That's worse than not
having
your
car
get moved.
It was there, but it wasn't where we had put it.
Oh, that'd be brutal.
They ended up calling a wrecker and actually driving down with the wrecker, paying for the wrecker to unlock our car. So it was
good.
They did everything they could. So like I said, I don't even want anybody to know who it was because I don't.
And all you want to do is get in a warm car at that.
Yeah, and it was dark. We'd been on the river since it just got daylight. We got off right at dark, and it was like. No.
Not to mention it was pouring rain on Saturday too.
Yeah, and it was starting to get really icy, and the launcher at. Was plowed, but it was still snow.
Yeah.
So it was.
Yeah.
It was
I know the launch you were talking about.
It was getting icy
by
the minute.
That's a bad launch to get stuck on, is that one you were telling me about.
In fact, the reason that they had to come down is because the tow truck said he wouldn't drive down there. He wanted
someone
to
drive down there. Yeah, because the tow truck's not going to be able to get out of there either.
It was a good time. But like we were talking about earlier, it's one of those good stories that you'll
remember.
You'll always remember and tell forever. And moral of the story is. Bring a spare key with you.
Seriously.
At the end of the day, you got no one to blame but yourself.
Yeah, bring a spare key with you. So.
Yeah.
Well, guys, you got anything else you guys want to throw in here or add or any exciting things you got coming up?
Excited for this spring. You know, we're always excited to keep going and see what the future's going to hold for us because.
Absolutely.
You know, we can always do better. And
where can people find you at if they want to book a trip?
Workmanoutfitters.com. Yep, workmanoutfitters.com.
WERKMAN.
Yep, it is not.
Because otherwise,
W-O.
If you do WO, you're going to end up in Idaho or Montana.
Yep,
there's a Workman Outfitters out there.
WERKMAN. We're on Instagram and Facebook. You know, send us a message or an email or give us a phone call. And.
Or if you're listening to this and you can't find them, get a hold of me. I'll point you in the right direction.
Either one. The only thing is I'm not in Michigan in the summer, so I go to Alaska and
So you got to deal with your dad.
So you got to deal with the old man.
And then I run the guide trips for smallmouth and pike.
Yep, I do a lot of. I do the cold water. He does the warm water. And other than that,
works out pretty well.
Other than that, that's about it.
Thank you for having us.
Of course.
It was fun. Thank you. Thanks for driving out. And
you bet.
Sitting down and drinking some beers with me and talking about fishing.
At least it wasn't nasty roads to drive here like yesterday.
They got a lot better than they were.
They did get a lot better.
That's for sure. All right. Well, thanks again, guys.
Stay.